So let me start by thanking the organizers for putting together such a great and diverse program and running such a smooth conference. So it was really a pleasure to be here, and maybe at the end of the session things I can say this. So what I want to report in this talk is actually I want to report on two works. So one work, the first work, was done in collaboration with the Jena All-Stars collaboration. So there were two students driving the project, Benjamin Knorr and Stefan Lippold. And then I also want to explain something that I did with my students in Nijmegen, which brings to the title of this talk. So since you are probably not all quantum gravity persons, and I'm the only asymptotic safety quantum gravity talk in the plenary here, let's explain what our goal is. So what we want to do is we want to derive a consistent and predictive description of the gravitational force valid on all length scales. So we want to start at the Planck scale or at sub-Planckian energy scales where space-time might be widely fluctuating. And then we want to connect this quantum gravity phase down to large distances. So here are typical distances that we are interested in. So at this distance, we form the cosmic microwave background. Particle physics typically happens at the order of 10 to the minus 19 meters. If we talk about solar system tests of gravity, we are talking at distances of 10 to the 12 meters. And down here in this plot, this should be an illustration of the visible universe. So then we are talking about the largest possible length scales that we can possibly observe. And looking at the distance scales, you see why you want to do RG. So you want to extrapolate physics over 60 orders of magnitudes. And this is something that will be very hard to do, for example, in Monte Carlo. So RG methods are predestined to explore these connections. So what should be the ingredients of our program? So we want to approach this problem of having gravity at all forces from a Wilsonian perspective. And the first thing we need to do this is we want to have a fixed point of the randomization group flow. Why is this important? So first, we want to have this fixed point to control the ultraviolet behavior of our theory. So in this case, we can control the UV divergences, the short distance behavior, and if the dimensionless coupling constants associated with this fixed point is finite, this should ensure that also scattering amplitudes don't have unphysical divergences. We want the construction to be predictive. So this translates into a property of the fixed point. So essentially, we only want to have a finite number of relevant deformations. So the RG flow that is tracked into the fixed point at high energies, this spans the UV critical surface. And what asymptotically conjectures is that our world actually lives on such a UV critical surface. Then our goal is to pinpoint where we are on this critical surface, and this is typically done by measuring relevant parameters of our theory. So by ensuring that the surface has finite dimension, we ensure that we can locate us with a finite number of measurements. Finally, we want to be able to connect to our real world, so we demand that the RG flow emanating from our fixed point approaches a regime where classical general relativity is actually a good approximation. So in this regime, we can then recover all the successful tests of general relativity, like the classical tests of perihelion shift, gravitational lensing results, nucleosynthesis, and many, many more. So these are the three basic requirements that we demand for this program to work. So the question, why are we not there? So we know how to quantize theories for a long time, and we have a classical description of the gravitational force. So here, We start with general relativity at the level of the action. This is encoded in the Einstein-Hilbert action. We have a Newton's constant. We have a cosmological constant in the game. And what makes this action very different from what we write down in the standard model is that Newton's constant actually comes with a negative mass dimension. Then we can analyze the consequences of this finding using a Wilsonian approach. So we want to compute the flow of this coupling constant. Okay, canonical way, we introduce dimensionless quantities. So here I introduce the RG scale K, and then we write down the beta function. Whatever this beta function will be, due to the canonical mass dimension, there is a part of the beta function that just is given by the mass dimension, and quantum corrections then come perturbatively at the order of g. Then you notice from the structure of the beta function that the Gaussian fixed point where this coupling constant vanishes is actually a saddle point. As a consequence, if you start with a theory with a positive Newton's constant, you will not end up in this free fixed point, but you will be driven away from it. So this is the statement that general relativity is not asymptotically free. So this is not how people started out within this program. So people were interested in actually computing counterterms. So this is the famous work by Gorov and Zagnotti. And they started from the Einstein-Hilbert action, leave out the cosmological constant. Then you find that at one loop order, there is no counterterm, on-shell counterterm that you can write down. So you have to push your computation to two loops. And then you see there is indeed a non-trivial counterterm that you can write down. This contains three powers of the Weyl tensor contracted here, and it comes with a non-zero coefficient. So then you notice that this type of counterterm is not of the form of your initial action, so it cannot be reabsorbed by redefinition of Newton's constant as you would do in a standard perturbatively randomizable field theory. So then you would need to add this new piece to the action in order to get rid of your divergences that will introduce a new free parameter. And you expect that this will go on at three loops. And in the end, you will end up by an infinite number of free parameters. So in the perturbative language, that's the same as we have seen before. The statement is, if we start from this action, we end up with a perturbatively non-randomizable theory. Okay, so maybe this is not a good fixed point. Let's see what fixed points are on the market that we can use instead. So the Gaussian fixed point, here I described what goes wrong with this fixed point. So if you start with the Einstein-Hilbert action, you perturbatively quantize in G. This doesn't work to describe gravity. Then people thought about, okay, we can add higher derivative couplings to our action. That cures the problem of randomizability, but it raises a new problem. We get negative norm states, and perturbatively you don't want them, so this is also not the theory that you are looking for. Then there's the proposal by Weinberg that there could be a non-Gaussian fixed point sitting on the theory space of gravity. This corresponds to an interacting field theory, and here I should stress that we are essentially working at a relativistic quantum field theory at this stage. So if this fixed point persists, then gravity could fall into the class of non-perturbatively randomizable field theories. Recently, there was a second proposal, so displaying a variant of a Gaussian fixed point, and instead of working with a relativistic theory, you break Lorentz symmetry at the fundamental level. So that leads to an interesting class of anisotropic fixed points where you can combine the features that we have above here. So you get higher derivative terms, but they come without the price of having negative norm states. So in essence, this could also be a feasible option for UV completion of gravity. But for the purpose of the talk, I will just focus on this idea that we have a relativistic fixed point, so focus on asymptotic safety. So this is the outline of the talk, introduction we have just done. Then I should quickly summarize the activity that has been going on in the field in the last couple of months. And then I will focus on three particular questions. So what is the role of the two-loop counter term in asymptotic safety? How can we go towards real-time computations in our framework? And I will briefly comment on the question of unitarity from our perspective. Okay, what has been going on? And in the last, the primary tool for investigating the asymptotic safety hypothesis, so it's based on a Wetterich-type flow equation. We see we use a background formalism to set this up. So G bar here is a background metric, and we look at fluctuations around the background. Related to the discussion that we have in the auditorium, there are three remarks I want to make here about this equation. So first, it's the role of the background formalism. If we set up this equation for gravity, this is not a choice, but it's a necessity. So if we do standard quantum field theory, we get precisely such a background for free. That's either our Minkowski metric or Euclidean metric. So in quantum gravity, the background metric essentially has to fulfill the role of also providing us the background that in a standard quantum field theory comes for free. So it will be hard to actually get rid of this point where you are standing on. Then the formulation itself, so we don't need to specify the initial action that we want to quantize, so we can search for this initial action dynamically on our theory space. So since we don't know what the action associated with our fixed point actually is, this is a highly desirable feature. And thirdly, it brings in plenty of approximation schemes which we can use to construct RG trajectories of this type. Okay. So over the years, this had been used at the background level. There were many, many truncations of the gravitational action that have been tested. So the story started out with Einstein-Hilbert. Now, polynomial R approximations, including R to the power of 35, have been studied, and people also included tensor structures. There is a new perpendicular direction to this diagram coming up. So this corresponds to vertex expansions, which are made on top of specifying the ansatz for the effective action. So this is not shown in this diagram here. So here is a summary of recent works and developments. So a brief summary, in many of the studies that we have seen, all essentially show the existence of a suitable non-Gaussian fixed point, both at the background level and at the level of the vertex expansion. We understand that this fixed point has a high predictive power, so the number of relevant directions could be low and as low as 3. From my personal perspective, this here is an important result. So if we study the field theory that is associated with the non-Gaussian fixed point in 2 dimensions, this can be linked to a unitary quantum field, conformal field theory. So this is the first link which could provide an intrinsic definition of our fixed point. And then there has been a lot of structural analysis going on, understanding the gauge dependent, the background dependence of our result. People were interested in deriving C theorems, deriving closures of the RG equations. So there's a lot to be done. So this refers to the case of pure gravity. A branch that came off, so instead of gravity, by now there's also a lot of development studying gravity coupled to matter systems. So the central results here in this area is that the non-Gaussian fixed point that we see in pure gravity has an analogous fixed point if we include the meta content of the standard model. There was a famous prediction of the Higgs mass based on asymptotic safety arguments. There are studies of Higgs-Yukawa systems on the way, and a lot has been going on in terms of studying cosmological implications of asymptotic safety. So, a lot of activity. On the other hand, the discussion in this conference showed that there are lots of open questions which are still discussed among the people in the field. So here are my favorite ones. So non-Gaussian fixed point, are the critical exponents really complex? What should we do with the background field? Well, how can we generalize our finite dimensional truncations to an infinite number of couplings? Or does asymptotic safety manifest itself in phenomenological signatures? So these questions indicate there's still a lot that needs to be done in this program. So let's focus on the questions that have been around. So this is a rather old question. It already started at the beginning of the program. So given that we have this asymptotically safe fixed point, what happens if we study the effect of the Gorov uncertainty counterterm? Will our fixed point be destroyed by adding this particular term to our truncation? So the setup in which we studied this question consists of the Einstein-Hilbert action down here, and here this is the two-loop counterterm that was found in the perturbative studies. Before actually understanding what the effect of this term is, let's recap what's going on in this sector down here. So this is our ansatz for the effective average action. We have two flowing coupling constants, G and lambda. We can compute the beta function. And from the beta functions, we read off that there are two fixed points. We have the Gaussian fixed point, and we have a non-Gaussian fixed point at positive Newton's constant and positive cosmological constant. So this would be the good candidate for a UV completion of gravity. So it's UV attractive in both G and lambda, and we see it has the potential of attracting the RG flow from the classical regime and provide the UV completion of our trajectories at high energies. Okay, how does this picture change once this operator is included? So following the RG perspective, we added precisely this term to our truncation ansatz and we equipped it with a running coupling constant. Then you can again introduce dimensionless quantities and start computing the beta functions. In terms of structures, there were two surprises coming up actually. So the first surprise was that once we include precisely this term, it does not feed back into the flow of the Newton's constant and the cosmological constant. So the beta functions for G and lambda are precisely the ones that we had before. Why is this the case? It has to do with the geometric structure of the counter term and the way that we construct our beta function. So this is the term that we added. On the right-hand side, our flow equation, we have the second derivative of this term with respect to the fluctuation fields. And if we work at background level, we then evaluated this flow, setting the fluctuation fields to zero. That means whatever I can do here in terms of taking two variations of the metric, the result will always be proportional to one power of the Weyl curvature. Then it's by construction, whatever index here I construct, the contraction of the Weyl curvature term vanishes. So if I have such a term, it cannot contribute to a structure that is linear in the Ricci scalar. So that tells me that the coupling constant sigma cannot enter into the beta functions in the Einstein-Hilbert sector. Okay. The second surprise is that we can write down the structure of the beta function for this new coupling constant. It will be cubic in the new coupling sigma with the coefficients C0 to C3 being functions of G and lambda. Again, the argument follows from taking two variations of this. So again, we have the equation that there is at least one power of the background Weyl tensor coming. And if I expand my flow equations in power of the curvature, then I get vertices. I take the vertex to the nth power. And this expansion in terms of curvature will give rise to a term e to the power n multiplied by the nth power of my coupling constant. And down here, I get additional terms which are lower power in the coupling constant. Since I'm only interested in terms which are cubic in C bar, I see that if I put this to 3, the series will start at finish at sigma to the power of 3. So that explains this highest power here. And from this lower power here, so we get the terms in sigma squared, sigma, and the constant terms. Okay, these are the structural insights. Now, in order to understand what's going on with fixed points, we have to understand what these coefficients C0 to C3 are. And then computer power came into the game. So we put the system onto a computer. I have to thank Andreas Wipf at this stage for providing the computational power for doing this computation. And in the end, the result took a rather simple form. So these are the coefficients. And the important takeaway message is that this coefficient C3 is found to be non-zero. Then you see here you have a cubic equation in sigma. And if you have a cubic equation, this equation always has a real root. So that means that as long as we have this coefficient C3 bigger than zero, then there is an extension of the non-Gaussian fixed point to the level of the Gorov and Zagnotti counterterm. So here are the numbers that we found. So if we compute, analyze the beta functions, we have the Gaussian fixed point with canonical scaling dimensions. And here's the position of the non-Gaussian fixed point. And it turns out that the new direction that is added is actually irrelevant. So if we have this additional coupling added to the game, that means we don't get an additional relevant parameter. And this is in contrast to what you see in perturbation theory. So the counterterm does not increase the number of free couplings in our theory. Then you can integrate the flow diagram that is depicted here. And you can also check that the crossover from the non-Gaussian fixed point to the Gaussian fixed point is actually intact. So our Gorov and Zagnotti extended fixed point still connects to a classical regime down here. So this settles the question, I think, in favor of asymptotic safety. Okay, new results. So the motivation for looking into the effect of a causal structure is the following. So far, we have done all our computations in a Euclidean setting. However, from experience, we don't live in a Euclidean world. So we experience that time passes, also in my talk. So how do we can we include the time direction in our framework? And the basic idea is, we don't want to encode our gravitational decrease of freedom in terms of a covariant metric. We want to resort to the ADM formalism. So in this case, what we do, we take our space-time and we put a foliation on our space-time. So there are spatial slices which come at equal time, and space-time is built up by a stack of these spatial slices. The effect is you have a preferred direction and you associate this preferred direction with time. the decomposition of our metric to ADM variables, that is well known. So here we have the line element. This can be written in terms of the covariant metric G mu nu, or in terms of these ADM fields, which tell you how to go from one time slice to another, and how you measure distance on the spatial slices. And here is the decomposition. So instead of having one field, we have a lapse, a shift vector, and metric on a spatial slice. And this decomposition is nonlinear. Okay, you decide for this set of variables. Then the Einstein-Hilbert action that we had before assumes a slightly different form. So we still have Newton's constant, cosmological constant, but the curvature term splits up into an extrinsic and an intrinsic curvature. And you also notice that not all of your fields are dynamical. So the lapse function and the shift vector hidden in here are actually Lagrange multipliers, which do not propagate a priori. Okay, for computing the beta functions, it's convenient to specify a background. And the idea is you can use a Friedmann-Robertson-Walker spacetime. Then there's a canonical parametrization of your fluctuation fields. So this is precisely the parametrization that is used by cosmologists if they want to study effects in the cosmic microwave background. So this is what we borrowed from them. And then it turns out that if you start from this action, there's a unique and canonical gauge fixing that you should come up with to complement this action. Of course, these two functions are the two functions that you would immediately write down. And you have to see where this thing comes from. So if we compute the second variation of this guy up here, here is the list in terms of component fields. So then you see and you notice that not all of the fields acquire a typical dispersion relation, which is energy squared plus spatial momentum squared. In fact, this will fail for most of the component fields. So if you look at the VV, it doesn't work. If you look at the EE, it doesn't work, and so on. Moreover, you get square roots of the Laplacian, which you also don't like. So what the gauge fixing that I wrote down then actually does is it equips all these components fields by propagators that are actually well-defined of the form energy squared plus momentum squared. Moreover, you see all the propagators come with a time direction and spatial derivatives. So in this setting, you are at a very good position to actually microtate your theory to real time and then run your flow equation actually having a real-time direction around. So upshot, we have a unique gauge fixing which leads to a well-defined Hessian for all the component fields that are sitting up here. Okay, based on this, you can run the usual procedure of constructing your beta functions and determining the corresponding flow diagram. And then it came to our surprise, so we recover the fixed point that we have seen in asymptotic safety based on covariant variables, but there is a new fixed point appearing up here saying this fixed point D. If you trace where this fixed point actually comes from, it comes down here from the singularity. So at lower dimension, it splits up from the singular point and it moves up there. This has the effect that in particular this sector, if we start from this RG flow down, we end up collectively in this endpoint C down here. So in this case, we have a completion of the flow at low energies, which is provided by this particular point. All the other things stayed as previously. So while adding the causal structure doesn't seem to affect the microscopic structure of our space-time, it might be of relevance if we ask questions about long-distance physics. Okay, this is what I wanted to say about bringing time into the game. So given the discussion that we had in the parallel session, I wanted to make two comments about unitarity. So we set up a framework which allows us to precisely test this question. So we started from Einstein-Hilbert. We added a single scalar field to the game. And what we allow here is a momentum-dependent structure function. And in the end, the structure of this function in terms of momenta actually allows you to determine the degrees of freedom that are sitting in your theory. So ideally, you want to determine the form of this function at the fixed point. So currently, due to technical limitations, we cannot do the full functional flow of this. So currently, we are limited to approximating this fk to a polynomial. And then you see that if you are at the level of the polynomials, you run into a problem. So if this polynomial has more than one real root, then you run into the problems that you encounter in perturbative quantization. So that would link the theory to Otsukaski instabilities. This can be avoided if your function f star actually is the product of a p squared times an analytic function, which is actually positive. So in this case, your degrees of freedom are precisely one massless particle, and having this extra momentum dependence will not introduce extra degrees of freedom. So how far are we in the computation? So we are at the level of having the beta functions for p to the fourth term. We integrated the beta function. We saw that our asymptotically safe fixed point still persists. It still has the same crossover behavior, but there are two additional fixed points. Now, what is remarkable of this diagram is if you are sitting at these UV fixed points, you see that the mass of the additional degrees of freedom is shifted to infinity. So despite working with a higher derivative theory, you don't get any extra degrees of freedom sitting up here. However, if we trace the flow to the infrared, we see that currently we cannot approach a region where the mass of these extra states becomes infinite. So we can make it arbitrary high, but not yet infinite. So that's the status here. This brings me to the conclusions. So in terms of analyzing fixed points, we are in good shape. So we have seen fixed points which could provide the UV completion of gravity at transplanckian scales. They have a transparent connection to classical low energy physics at the level where we could test it. They can extend to gravity matter systems. And by using the ADM decomposition, we are now in the position of making real-time correlation functions and cosmological investigations based on the FRG. Okay, this brings me to the outlook and the final announcement. So we will have a roadmap workshop on precisely these questions to be held in the Netherlands in Leiden. So this will be February next year. And announcement will follow over the asymptotic safety mailing list. So if you are not on this list, inscribe. Thank you.